people of God. Come on, give God a hand clap of praise all over the building. Hallelujah. This is the day the Lord has made. I will rejoice. Hallelujah. Scripture says, oh, magnify the Lord with me. With me. Amen. Let us exalt his name together. We're so grateful to see all of you that have made your way out to the sanctuary on today. We're grateful for those who have dialed in via our conference call, and we're grateful for those who will view us later online. We're just grateful for everything and everybody. Amen. I believe we're in for another glorious time in the Lord. Amen. Amen. You know, I believe in the Lord had laid on my heart to, when we start this ministry, to have a ministry of participation. Amen. Participatory. Say that fast three times. Participatory. Yeah. We want everybody to be involved. Amen. Now, you have heard in the previous weeks from our anointed ministers and deacons and deaconess, but you know we have other laypersons who are just as anointed. Amen? Amen. Amen. So in the future, in addition to hearing from our ministers, our deacons, and our deaconess, we will hear from some of our laypersons. And for those of you that feel you have a word of exhortation, I know all of us can pray. Amen. Amen. If you feel comfortable with coming up and getting the service started, we want to see you here. Amen. Amen. We want to see you here. Many of you have already been used, and I'm so grateful for your willingness to volunteer and be an active part in this ministry. On today, we are blessed to have one of our remote members. Normally, most of you hear her on the line. She is our remote member who resides currently in Port Hueneme, California. Amen. But she's in the house today. Amen. Amen. So I'm going to ask now if Felicia Nickelberry would come. She'll be followed by our own Felix Smith, who will give us a song, and I'll be back with the word. Amen? Amen. Amen.
Good morning. David said, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Good morning, my top partners. I want you to know I feel like David this morning. I'm so excited. I'm so glad to be in your presence. There's nothing like being in fellowship with our brothers and sisters in Christ. You probably have heard my voice and recognized the voice, but putting a face with the name and the voice and all is just something unique. So this morning, I'm just, we have a saying in my family where, you know, we all get together, and sometimes some family members are a little more excited than others. You know, so after we're all together, we're loving each other, hugging on each other, we'll say, who got the So Glad Award today? So I want everybody to know I get the So Glad Award today, okay? So I'm just happy to be in your presence. I just want you to ponder on something for just a few moments. I want you to think about having something that's just nice to have versus something that you need to have. You know, there's a big difference in nice to have and need to have. And what I thought about is, you know, if you go visit a girlfriend or go to a family member's house, they'll invite you in, they'll give you a seat, and they'll ask you, you know, would you like to have a glass of water? And you may think about it like, you know, I'm not really thirsty, but yeah, you know, I'd like to have a glass of water. That's a nice to have. Then I thought about a marathon runner. I'm by no way a marathon runner, not even a marathon walker, but I like to get out and exercise. And I thought, you know, when I'm out exercising, after exercising, I'm kind of, you know. And a marathon runner, they practice, they exercise, they condition, they endure for what's to come. And I thought about that sitting in the living room, being offered a glass of water, versus a marathon runner. And after they finish the marathon, you know, often they'll have a team of people that work with them. And I thought their team comes up to them, and often they'll give them some water because they need to have some water because their body has gone through something and you know, they need that hydration, that conditioning back. So they need to have water. So when you think about the nice to have when you're just visiting with someone, versus after running a marathon, you need to have some water. God just spoke to me when I thought about those two analogies, and he showed me that he is essential in my life. Essential. So if he's essential, he's not a nice to have. It's nice to have brethren and sisterin and, you know, a place to worship. But I need God. Need him every day. Need him every hour, every minute, every second. And I thought about that, and I thought, you know, sometimes I think we place God here or shift him here. And he just showed me that you need to have me every moment of your life. And as we go into worship today, I want you to think about that. You know, where is God in your life? Is he a nice to have? Or is he a need to have? And when you need to have something in your life, you long for it. You work to get it. So today, we're here in the sanctuary, and those on the call, I'm normally on the call, I'm in the sanctuary today, but those on the call, we're all here because we need to have the Lord. We need to have him in our lives. I thought about a scripture, Psalms 42:1. I'll be reading from the New Living Translation. And it reads, as the deer longs for streams of water, so I long for you, O Lord. So as we go into this worship experience today, just meditate on that, longing after the Lord. And whatever you need from him while we're here together, while we're on the line or even viewing on YouTube, search for that, long for that, that need of the Lord in your life. We've all been given our prayer requests. Everyone's received the prayer request list. We have a couple of additional names that we'd like to pray for this morning. Under bereavement, we have the family of Miss Beverly Hudson. And for healing, we have Mr. Kevin and Mrs. Jackie Brooks, who are currently live in California. So let's go before the Lord this morning. Father, we thank you. We thank you for this time of worship, Lord. Lord, we praise you for who you are in our life, Lord. Lord, we thank you for your excellence. We thank you for just being there where we can touch you, we can feel you, Lord. Not as a nice to have, but a need to have, Father. Lord, we thank you for this opportunity to come together as brothers and sisters in Christ just to worship, Lord. Lord, we pause and we pray for those on the list, those names that were called, those names that weren't called, but distribute to us all, Lord. Touch each and every need that's within us, Lord. Each and every need. You know the specific need, Lord. Even those that their name isn't on the list, those names weren't called, just those of us that are here, we all have needs for you, Lord. And we just ask you to touch and meet us right at the place of our need, Lord. And as we go into this worship experience, Father, we just ask you to have your way. You can already have your way, but we just surrender to you and give that to you and ask you, have your way in this place, Lord. Dwell among us, Lord. Up and down the aisles, Lord. From person to person, Lord. Dwell among us. Lord, touch every participant in the service today, every singer, every speaker, every prayer that goes forth. And Lord, touch the man of God that will come with the anointed word to deliver to us on today, Lord. We give you the praise. We give you the praise, Lord. We thank you, Lord, and we glorify your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you.
Everybody say blessed.
Amen. All right, well, here we go. Everybody say blessed.
Blessed. Blessed. Blessed.
Yeah.
Blessed.
Yeah. Yeah, 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 yeah.
Bless, bless, bless.
Say, yeah.
Bless, bless.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
Bless.
Check this out. We're blessed in the city. We're blessed in the field. We're blessed when we come and when we go. Down every stronghold, sickness and poverty must cease, for the devil is defeated. putting on.
Have mercy, Lord. Forgive me, Lord.
He sent the information and cast thine enemies away. He's standing up within me. So let me hear you say, we're blessed in the city.
The name of the Lord.
Hallelujah. Blessed in the city. Blessed in the field. Blessed when we come and when we go. Anybody glad about that? Oh my God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you wasn't blessed when you got here, you ought to be blessed now. Amen. Because we've already heard something we need. Amen. And we need to have a song of inspiration to lift us up. We need some words of inspiration to lift us up. And we always need to have a little talk with Jesus. We always need to pray. Amen. Amen. I'm excited about what the Lord has done and what he's doing and all of the many things he got lined up for me and for you that we haven't even got to yet. The scripture says the steps of a good man, a good woman, are ordered by the Lord. And as long as you stay on that path where your footsteps have been ordered by the Lord, guess what? You're going to be blessed in the city. Blessed in the field. Blessed when you come and when you go. Hallelujah. We thank God and praise God for another privilege to stand behind this sacred desk and lift up the name of Jesus. Recognizing God first, who is first in all of our lives. Recognizing all the members of clergy who are here today. All of our deacons, our officers to First Lady. Again, those in the sanctuary, those who have called in, and those who will view us online. Greetings in the matchless name of Jesus. Hallelujah. That's the name above every name. At the name of Jesus, hallelujah, every knee shall bow. Every tongue must confess that Jesus Christ is Lord of all. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we thank you. Lord God, we praise you, we magnify you, we glorify you. Oh God, we just worship you just because of who you are. Just an awesome, loving, kind, forgiving God. And then we praise you for all that you've done and all that you're doing in our lives. So, God, we thank you for everything you've allowed us to experience up until this point. But now, God, as we go into your word, I ask for clarity of mind and clarity of speech. I pray, oh God, that you would give me the anointing that makes preaching easy. I pray, oh God, that the anointing will move upon this place. It will permeate every vessel in this building, oh God, so that your word will get a hearing. Oh God, I ask that you would let the words of my mouth, the meditation of my heart, be acceptable in thy sight, oh Lord, my strength. My Redeemer, my everything, my all in all. And all who believe in the power press, amen? Amen. Amen. Come on, let's give the Lord another hand clap of praise. Thank the Lord, thank the Lord, thank the Lord. Ushers, you may retire from your station. Thank you so much for your service. You know, the Word of God states in 2 Timothy 3 and 16a that all scripture is given by inspiration of God. That means all the scripture that you like, all the scripture that you don't like. Amen. All of that is given by inspiration of God. Consequently, all sermons that are scripturally based should be given by inspiration of God. Amen. Amen. So just like all scriptures won't make you shout, all sermons won't make you shout either. Yeah, the word is intended to instruct, to correct, to challenge, to inspire, and to encourage each and every one of us along this Christian journey. So with this message today, you might not be able to get your shout on right away. But if you listen with an open mind and with spiritual discernment, I believe you'll be able to get your amen on as I proceed. But I need you to pray with me. Will you do that? Will you pray with me? I didn't hear enough from over on this side. Will y'all pray with me? Hallelujah. You know, as we continue with our Black History celebration today, I believe we all know, but not everyone will acknowledge that there has been a great disservice done to African American people down through the years. Even today in this 21st century, more tribulation and trauma continues to be visited upon us. You know, since the former presidential administration, this disservice has escalated to the degree that it's just as much overt and physical as it is covert and psychological. Great damage has been done to the pride, the self-worth, the self-esteem, and self-respect of African-American people.
But rest assured that the African American experience is not all gloom and doom by any stretch of the imagination, for it includes many positive developments in our history as a people. For example, there was the advent of the American Civil Rights Movement and the Black Revolution during the 1950s and 60s and moving into the 70s under the respective visions of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. and Malcolm X. There were also the liberating cries of Black Power. Black is beautiful. I'm black and I'm proud. And I am somebody that attempted to elevate the African American's esteem from the doldrums of despair to at least the status quo. But even today, a considerable number of African Americans live as though these cries were never uttered. These echoes of pride, identity, and self-determination are nothing more than a faded memory to some and mean absolutely nothing to many of our younger generation. Now, I'm certainly not dissing our young people, because there are also older African Americans who never embraced the renaissance of cultural pride and identity. So it's no great mystery what has happened. The infrastructure of discrimination has experienced a resurgence in updated forms that continue to teach us to hate ourselves. This has resulted in an escalation of gang violence, black-on-black crime, domestic violence, drug trafficking coupled with drug abuse, a decline in health care, leading to more physical ailments, mental breakdowns, and even suicide. So as a preacher and a pastor, I'm always seeking for ways to heal the spirit of the African American, and all people for that matter, so that they can rise up and be the people of God he wants them to be. The challenge is to break down the strongholds of many years of social programming and lead beyond pretense and denial to a genuine identity and authenticity. There is a resource of great promise and effectiveness in a movement called Afrocentricity that surfaced several years ago. This movement is a multidisciplinary program with both scholarly and popular approaches designed to rescue African American history from academic and ideological forced exile. Are y'all still praying with me? So once again, my goal as a preacher of the gospel is to introduce this wide breadth of scholarship and information to you in a way that is both spiritually and practically discernible and helpful for you. My challenge is to craft a message in a way that makes reception and retention of this knowledge easy and desirable for the young and the old, blacks, whites, and all races, including all those of all socioeconomic levels, while at the same time satisfying the basic requirements of inspiring the hearts of all listeners. You know, when I speak regarding any issue from a pro-black perspective, I want it clearly understood that I'm not anti-white or anti any other race of people. Basically, I understand clearly that it will require all of us, every race, to make a substantial difference in the world. And I know personally there are already many white brothers and sisters and others of others' race who have partnered with black people and other oppressed groups in the fight for social, racial, and economic justice. Some are theologically conservative, others are theologically liberal, but they all demonstrate progressive thinking with regard to the African American estate in this country. My hope is that these sermons I deliver during Black History Month demonstrate a prophetic indignation over what has happened to black people in this country for many, many years. I also hope that these messages demonstrate a prophetic passion for truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. I hope to build up a people who have been torn down, and insofar as they are my people, the work cannot be done dispassionately. However, these sermons are not so intense that they will not preclude an attempt at humor, a feature I hope will not be missed. So as a pastor tasked with teaching and preaching God's word, one of the most satisfying experiences for me is when I have someone tell me that the message really ministered to them. My aunt, I've mentioned this before, Sister Effie Burnett often tells me when I talk to her how I relate the stories in the Bible to what's happening today. She said, those Bible stories don't do you any good unless you know how to help you now. Yeah, so when I get feedback from my senior saints like her and Mother Nate, and then I get positive feedback from young people like Amari, and then I get feedback from all those groups in between, it confirms that the message has been received. So continue to pray for me and with me that the Holy Spirit will continue to download into me what he desires you to receive. Y'all ready to get into the message today? Amen. Those of you who are physically able to stand with me for the reading of the foundational text. Found in Genesis chapter 39, verses 1 through 5. Again, for those of you who are on our distribution list, I attempt to send these out. I was late getting them out today, so hopefully you got them. But those who are at home, hopefully you can pull them up and follow along with us. Genesis 39, beginning at verse 1. Now Joseph had been taken down to Egypt. And Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh, captain of the guard, an Egyptian, brought him from the Ishmaelites who had taken him down there. The Lord was with Joseph, and he was a successful man, and he was in the house of his master, the Egyptian. And his master saw that the Lord was with him, and that the Lord made all he did to prosper in his hand. So Joseph found favor in his sight and served him. Then he made him overseer of his house and all that he had put under his authority. So it was from that time that he had made him overseer of his house and all that he had that the Lord blessed the Egyptian's house for Joseph's sake. And the blessing of the Lord was on all that he had in the house and in the field. Amen. Today's message is entitled, Educated from Egypt Experiences. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord, educated from Egypt experiences. You know, we should always be looking in every situation and circumstance we find ourselves in, whether it's positive or negative, we should be looking to learn something from that experience. Amen? You know, in the song, Go Down Moses, it's a very familiar African Negro spiritual. This song describes an event in the Old Testament from the Bible, specifically from Exodus 5 and 1. And the Lord spoke unto Moses, Go unto Pharaoh and say unto him, Thus said the Lord, Let my people go, that they may serve me. This is the passage where God commands Moses to demand from Pharaoh the release of the Israelites from bondage in Egypt. This opening verse, which was published by the Jubilee Singers in 1892, says, When Israel was in Egypt land, let my people go. Oppressed so hard they could not stand, let my people go. Go down, Moses, way down in Egypt land. Tell old Pharaoh to let my people go. This song was made famous by Paul Robeson, whose voice was so deep and resonant, it attained the status of the voice of God from some. On February 7, 1958, the song was recorded in New York City and sung by Louis Armstrong with Cy Oliver's orchestra. There's a little black history fact for you there. When most people think about Egypt in the Bible, they think about the Hebrew slave under heavy oppression and hard taskmasters. A place where it took 400 years, 10 plagues, and a showdown at the Red Sea for God's people to be set free. But that's not the whole story of Egypt in the Bible. That's only the Exodus story. Before there was an Exodus, there was a Genesis. Before there was a Moses, there was a Joseph. Today we want to take a look at Egypt from a different perspective because Egypt's place in the Bible should not be viewed just from a negative viewpoint. There are clearly some positive aspects of Egypt that we want to remember because there are valuable lessons to be learned from Egypt experiences. Because Egypt is not only about being in bondage, it's also about trusting and believing until you get a breakthrough. Egypt is not only about blood, sweat, and tears. It's about blessings and salvation and triumph. Egypt is not only about disappointment that leads to despair. It's also about dedication that leads to deliverance. Egypt is actually symbolic of the world today, with real people and real problems and real possibilities. Not all positive, but certainly not all negative. Not all good, but neither is it all bad. Egypt is not a place reserved for special folk. It's everybody's place. Because we can't get to where we're going without going through Egypt. What am I talking about? You can't go from Ethiopia, the place where we began, to Israel, the place where we belong, without going through Egypt. Abraham couldn't go from Ur of the Chaldees, the place of his past, to Canaan, the place of his promise, without going through Egypt. Jesus couldn't go from Bethlehem, the place of his birth, to Jerusalem, the place of his resurrection, without going through Egypt. Joseph couldn't get from his father's house, just an errand boy, to Pharaoh's palace as a prime minister without going through Egypt. So it is actually Joseph's story that impels us to take another look at Egypt, because we will all experience our own Egypt-like situations along this journey. And Joseph's story will help to prepare us for what we will face. Even though we may be delayed in Egypt for longer than we like, we might not even like how we got there. Joseph's story lets us know that in Egypt, there is something for us. And praise the Lord, in Egypt, God is always with us. Sometimes we have to go through our own Egypt-like scenarios to be reminded that God is truly good to us. Sometimes the tables must be turned. Sometimes they must be overturned for us to realize that whatever blessing we experience, they all come from God. You Bible scholars know that Joseph was the favorite son of Joseph, the firstborn of Jacob's beloved Rachel. Y'all should remember this from a message just a couple of weeks ago. Joseph didn't work in the field or tend to the flocks like his siblings. Joseph did a little light work around the house and just carried messages from his father's house to his brothers in the field. But even with that little bit that he did, he wore the best clothes, he had the easiest chores, and he was shown the most love. Actually, Joseph was nothing but a little tattletale. He brought bad reports from his father to his father from his brother's activities. But in Egypt, the tattletale had a tale told about him, by Potiphar's wife. That lets you know, you reap what you sow. Come on now. Then Joseph's fine clothes became tattered and dirty from the years in prison. The favored son of Jacob became the rejected slave and special to no one. You know, the interesting thing is that the whole time Joseph is at home, living a carefree life, God is not mentioned anywhere in the text. But once Joseph is in Egypt, in Genesis 39, it reveals to us four times, in verses 2, 3, 21, and 23, that the Lord was with him. It also reveals twice in verses 3 and 23 that the Lord caused him to prosper. You know, this revelation that God can cause me to prosper, that is what inspires me to keep on keeping on. I know that when I obey God, I don't have to worry about anything. I don't have to worry about anything holding me back or anything keeping me down, because God will make me prosper. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We're going to come back to Genesis 39, but listen to 2 Corinthians 9, 6 through 8. But this I say, he which soweth sparingly shall also reap sparingly, and he which soweth bountifully shall also reap bountifully. Every man according as he purposes in his heart, so let him give, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loves what? A cheerful giver. Now here's the verse I want you to key in on. Verse 8 said, God is able to make, glory to God, all grace abound towards you, that ye always have all sufficiency in all things may abound to every good work. Praise the name of the Lord. Listen to how 2 Corinthians 9 and 8 reads from the Amplified Bible. God is able to make all grace. And then Amplified, it breaks you down what that all grace is. That's every favor and earthly blessing come to you, not in a little bit, but in abundance. Oh, my God. so that you may always, somebody shout always,
always.
And under all circumstance, somebody say all circumstance. What are you talking about? Pandemic? Recession? It doesn't matter. God gonna make you prosper. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And whatever the need, you're gonna be self-sufficient. What does that mean? Possessing enough to require no aid or support and furnished in abundance for every good work and charitable donation. Glory to God. Now, if God can make all of that happen for me under all situations, why should I worry? Why should I be stressed about anything? When you're doing things the Lord's way, even when you are suffering persecution, God will bless you. Y'all wasn't ready. It doesn't matter even if you get mistreated, lied on, dogged out, disrespected, God will bless you. Glory to God. Not only that, he'll bless folk around you. Oh my God. This is revealed in the latter part of Genesis 39 and 5. It said, the Lord blessed the Egyptian's house just for Joseph's sake. In other words, I got one of my people in there, so I'm going to make sure everything is good. Hallelujah. This is why I'm striving to live right. You know, as a father, a grandfather, a son, a brother, a pastor, a friend, I want my biological family and my church family and everybody around me to be blessed just because of their association with me. Hallelujah. And I know this can happen. I know it can happen, Henry, because the scripture says in Proverbs 20 and 7, again, this is from the Amplified Version, the righteous man, that's the just man, the godly man. This includes all women and everybody who walks in their integrity, blessed. What does that mean? Happy, fortunate, enviable are his children. That's his family after him. So no matter what you're going through right now, discriminated against, racially profiled, job stress, financial stress, relationship stress, sickness, anxiety, whatever it might be, hold your head up, because I'm praying for you that your breakthrough will come swiftly. And I want to tell you, there's not a day go by that I don't lift up every member and every ministry of this church. Not a day go by, because I know I'm the righteous of God. And I know that God hears my prayers. Hallelujah. And I want to teach you through God's word how to have the blessed assurance that God hears you as well. Amen. This assurance doesn't come from the pastor or the preachers or deacons or church officers. This assurance comes from you walking uprightly and obeying God's word. Listen to what the scripture says in Psalm 84, 11 and 12. For the Lord God is a sun and shield. What does that mean? Divine protection. That the Lord will give grace and glory. No good thing will he withhold from them who walk uprightly. That's divine provision. O Lord of hosts, blessed is the man, the woman, the person who trusts in thee. You know, as I said earlier, it's interesting to note that the whole time Joseph was at home living a carefree life, God is not mentioned anywhere in Scripture. Now, certainly not that God wasn't with Joseph while he was at home. But perhaps Joseph is like some of us when we get blessed. We've achieved more and been given a certain status. And the blessings are coming at us so fast and trouble seems so far away that there's nothing in our walk that talks or points to praising God for all that he's done, because we're too busy enjoying the blessing. Yeah, and maybe even taking credit for some of them. Taking about what I did and my and me and my and all of that. Sometimes things are going so well for us, we tend to forget that God is the source of all of our blessing. Oh, but then trouble comes. Nobody is helping us when we can't seem to help ourselves. Oh, but then our darkest moment, the blessings come, the doors are open, and the prayers are answered. Then we realize it was God all the time, and it wasn't anything that we would do. And this is what Egypt experiences teach us. And Egypt experience teaches one to testify, if it had not been for the Lord who was on my side, where would I be? An Egypt experience causes one to sing, I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour, I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee. I need thee, I need thee. Every hour, every second, every minute of the day, I need it. I need it, see. This is something essential to me. This is not a nice to have. I need this. Oh, bless me. Now, my Savior, I come to thee. An Egypt experience makes one rejoice when they remember victory verses like, God will never leave me. He will never forsake me. Because the Lord was with Joseph, he didn't have to wait until he left Egypt to see God at work for his situation to be turned around. God provided for Joseph while he was in Egypt. Because it was in Egypt that Joseph married Asenath, the daughter of an Egyptian priest, who bore Joseph two half-African sons who would become tribes of Israel and whose names testify to God's presence in Egypt. He named one Manasseh, which means making me to forget, because God made him forget all of his hardships. You know, education from Egypt experiences proved to us that God can not only make us forget past pain, you know, that's what's gonna help us. The things that we try, they won't help us. You know, having a, just go to the bar and drinking shots, That's not going to help you. Snorting a line, that's not going to help you. Shooting up with something, that's not going to help you. Another piece of cake or another piece of chicken, that's not going to help you. A new job, a new career, a new car, that's not going to help you. Even a new boot, come on, that won't help you. Some of these things may ease the pain, but they won't erase the pain. They may cover the sorrow, but it won't cure the sorrow. They may hide the hurt, but they won't heal the hurt. Joseph's pain didn't go away when he left prison. They didn't go away when he received a job in Pharaoh's house or when he gained respect in Egypt. The pain and sorrow subsided because God gave Joseph what he needed so he can let the past go. What are you talking about, Pastor? For the love of a father he lost, God gave him the love of a Pharaoh. For the coat of many colors that was torn and sprinkled with blood, God gave him the finest linen clothes, a gold chain, and a signet ring. For the loneliness he must have felt in a foreign land, God gave him a boo. Yeah, gave him a wife, a faithful African woman. So when the second son was born, Joseph named him Ephraim, which means to be fruitful. For God had made Joseph fruitful, don't miss this, in the land of his misfortune. So God doesn't have to move you anywhere to bless you. God can bless you real good, right where you are. Somebody needs to hear that. And isn't it just like God to do for us what we can't do for ourselves? Isn't it just like God to give us hope in despair, to give us strength in weakness, comfort us in time of grief, and give us peace in the midst of confusion? Isn't it just like God to lift us up when we cast down, open his arms up for us when we feel lonely, and give us love when we're lonely, and heal us when others leave us hurting? Thanks be to God that we don't have to wait until we get to the promised land to get what we need. Education from Egypt experiences teach us to say, all that I needed, thy hand has provided. Great is thy faithfulness. Education from Egypt experience enable us to believe weeping may endure for a night, but joy will sure enough come in the morning. Education from Egypt experience teach us to testify earth has no sorrow that heaven cannot heal. I want to share with you one more thing about Egypt. Y'all doing all right? Egypt isn't just a place of slavery. It's also a place of salvation. For 7 years, Joseph saved grain in Egypt's storehouses. So when the famine came, Egypt was the only place that had food. The scripture reveals in Genesis 4 and 57, all the world came to Joseph in Egypt to buy grain. So not only was Egypt saved through the famine, but the rest of the world was saved because of Egypt. When the children of Israel had spent 400 years in slavery in Egypt, Moses, who was born in Egypt, reared by Egyptians, educated in Egypt, and a prince in the court of Pharaoh, became the emancipator of Israel, which led them across the Red Sea. When Herod sought to make Jesus, to take Jesus' life and kill all of the baby boys under 2 years old, Joseph and Mary took Jesus to Egypt, and Egypt's border saved the Savior of the world. So education from Egypt experiences reveal that salvation doesn't always happen in places that we expect, among the people we know, or in ways that we can predict. Education from Egypt experiences reveal that salvation occurs when and where God acts. But most importantly, it happens for a purpose. God did not save us to remain in Egypt, but look, he saves us to get through Egypt. Y'all missed that. God doesn't save us to remain where we are. God saves us to move us to where he wants us to be. Listen, Abraham didn't stay in Egypt, but he left and kept on going to find a city whose founder and maker was God. Moses didn't stay in Egypt, but he left and kept on going until he met God on the backside of the Midian desert in a burning bush. Even Joseph didn't stay in Egypt. For when Israel left, they took Joseph's bones with them just as they had promised. And Jesus didn't stay in Egypt, but he kept on going until he got to Calvary, where he was crucified, buried in a borrowed tomb, resurrected, and ascended to the right hand of God. But Jesus' travels are not done yet, because one day, come on now, he's coming back. He's coming back for a church without spot or wrinkle. And I want you to know, when the saints go marching in, that song says, I want to be in that number. Let me tell you, I'm going to be in that number. When the saints go marching, anybody else know that you know that I'm going to be in that number when the saints go marching in? But you know, metaphorically, as I bring this message to a close, Egypt is a place where we must sometimes travel through to understand that God is always with us, that he can heal us, that he can deliver us, that he can save us from anything or anybody that tries to harm us or halt us. However, somebody say, however. Egypt is not our final destination. So don't get comfortable where you are. God is ready to elevate you to another place. Education from Egypt experience teach us to say, Lord, I'm striving, trying to make 100. Because 99 and a half just won't do. Education in Egypt allows us to say, I'm pressing on the upward way. New heights I'm gaining every day. Still praying as I onward bound. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. So if you're here today, if you're viewing online or you're listening via the conference call, and you happen to be making your journey through your Egypt-like experience, please don't try to make that journey all by yourself. If you don't know Christ and the pardon of your sin, you need to receive him today and join this band of believers here at the Tabernacle Praise Christian Church. Believers who pray for each other with the confidence that no weapon formed against us will prosper. We know they're going to be formed. We know we're going to face some trials. We know we're going to face some tribulation. We know we're going to face some enemies. We're going to face some haters. We're going to face some sickness and sorrow, but none of that will prosper. Hallelujah. So the key to living an abundant life, even in these tough times, is to accept Jesus and get to know him, because there's nothing better than knowing Jesus. He'll pick you up and turn your life around. There's nothing better to knowing Jesus. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Hallelujah. Come on, give God praise. Come on, give him glory. Give him honor. Amen. Won't you stand with me as the invitation to discipleship is extended? If there's a person or persons here in the building that want to accept Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, we invite you to come. You can come by letter, you can come as a candidate for baptism, or you can come by your own Christian experience. So if you're here and you fall into that category, or if you just have some questions about this ministry, make sure that you see Minister LaBrenda Hill, who's on my right, your left, before you leave, and we'll try and get those questions answered or get you hooked up to the team. Amen? Amen. But if you happen to be viewing online, or if you happen to be listening to us via conference call, and you also have some questions, or you want to become a member of this band of believers, you can send your questions or your contact information to labhill60@gmail.com. Again, that's labhill60@gmail.com. Or you can text to 901-319-5588. God bless you. God bless you. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Amen. Have you been blessed by anything today? Come on, if you've been blessed by anything today, give God praise. Give him glory. Give him honor. Hallelujah. Well, now it's time for us to be a blessing to the Lord in our giving. We're going to receive our announcements and welcome any visitors if we have any. Then we'll be ready to go. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. What a blessed message that we had today. What a blessed message. Amen. Although we may be traveling through our Egypt experiences, we don't have to be scared, do we? But we always have God on our side, as long as we trust in him and we're obedient to him. Amen. Thank you, Pastor, for that encouraging message. Our giving affirmation comes from Luke. Comes from Luke 6:38. And it goes like this: give, and it will be given to you. A good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, will be poured into your lap. For with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. To those present and virtual top partners and friends, we'd like to take this opportunity to thank all of you who are supporting us financially. And we would like to ask that you continue to do so if you so desire. And we have several methods by which you may give. And it goes like this. The first, you may text TOP to 833-245-7470 and follow the prompts. The second option is to download the TOP app from the Apple Store for iPhone users and the Google Play Store for Android users. Then click on the giving icon at the bottom. You may also mail your contribution, as always, to Tabernacle of Praise Christian Church, 4325 Hacks Cross Road, Memphis, Tennessee, 38125. And for those of you who are present today, there will be baskets in the rear for your gifts. As a reminder, the strategic seed for the month of February is $37.04, taken from Psalm 37:4, and it goes like this: delight yourself also in the Lord, and he shall give you the desires of your heart. And per Pastor Nate, God has promised to take care of all of our needs according to his riches in glory. However, when you delight in the Lord by living, loving, and giving according to his word, the Lord delights in you by even granting you some of the desires of your heart. Amen. We also would like to take this time to invite you to our Power Up sessions at 5:30 a.m. on Wednesday, and then our Bible study services at 6:30 p.m. Both are Central Standard Time. You may join by simply dialing 732-434-2918. It is also recommended that you dial in about 10 minutes ahead of time to assure your connection. And I am positive that you will be truly blessed. At this time, if we have any first-time visitors, if you'd like to stand so that you may be recognized. Okay, well, if not, we hope that something was said, a song sung, or even a friendly hello was given to you, and perhaps you'll be back to join us again. Thank you.
Good morning, Saints. How y'all doing? All right, all right. So, we are up here to first say we love the pastor and first lady. We are glad to say that I think it was maybe 2 weeks after we got married, we came to Top, and it was, you know, it's from day one, it's been an awesome experience. It's been an experience where we both grown spiritually, close together, and you know, we've, in my opinion, we've gotten closer to God, and it's been an experience that gave both of us hope, because our previous worship or church that we were at, when we first met, it was a lot of things going on, and we can honestly say that none of that happened here. And so it gave us hope. Although, you know, I grew up in the church and everything, when you experience hurt in church, it can go with you a long way. But I can honestly say we've made friends, we've made brothers, sisters here that we can honestly call our friends. But God is calling us to go elsewhere. I called Pastor and spoke with him the other week. And I thank God for a pastor that, you know, first of all, we didn't get kicked out. And we didn't have to leave on bad terms. But we've been praying, and we believe that God is leading us to make a move. And we are still going to be fellowshipping with Top. And so we're not leaving on bad terms. No one has offended us at all. This is a move that we've prayed on, and we're being led by God. So we wanted to come in and say goodbye until later, you know. And it's definitely on great, you know, nothing negative at least. But we definitely, it's a bittersweet moment for us. It's kind of hard to stand up here, you know, and say this, but just wanted to face you all as our brothers, our sisters in Christ, and as our pastor. You know, he, like I said, we've been here since we got married, and so it's been a really great growing experience spiritually for us, great foundation for us, for our kids, and we just wanted to say, see you guys later. We love you all.
Did you want to say something?
You know, as he stated, it's certainly a bitter, sweet moment. But again, I think I'm so thankful. One of the things when I reflect on the way that we've grown and, you know, initially with us coming here, Top is certainly a reflection of God's love. You know, when the word of God says, with love and kindness have I drawn thee, and you all have given, you know, you gave me hope again that, you know, church is really a reflection of God. Yes, Camille, praise him. So I just want to say thank you all, and you're still family to us. It's definitely not goodbye. You will see us, you know, because again, you all are family to us and will forever remain in our heart as family. So again, thank you so much for welcoming us with open arms and for your leadership and guidance, Pastor and First Lady.
Amen. Amen. We certainly thank God and praise God for the service that the Hardys have rendered. You know, when they came, it was just two of them. Amen. So they multiplied. Amen. God is blessed. Many of you may not know, but this couple, it was through their vision that we started initially our prayer ministry. They were so into God and prayer. They said, "Pastor, can we have prayer on Saturday?" I said, "Shoot, yeah. Yeah, we can always pray." And I'm grateful to God for their love that they had for him and the love for this ministry. So we got that, and we've springboarded on from there. And Minister Shirley is just taking it and run with it with that prayer ministry. But you know, everything has a start. Amen. And I'm grateful that the Lord led them to have that vision. So it's good to have other visionaries under the umbrella. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And I believe in giving credit where credit is due. But we want to pray for them. And I'm going to ask our members if you just stand and let join us in prayer as we pray with them and for them. Amen. Gracious God, our Father, it's in the awesome and matchless name of Jesus that we come thanking you, O God, for the ministry and the service that the Hardys has given us during their time here. We thank you for leading us here. We thank you, O God, for what they contributed in every area. As Isaiah elevated, Levinson served as a deacon, and then the Lord called him into ministry, and Terica, but through the prayer ministry, and served with the deaconess and ministers' wives and with our youth. And I thank you, O God. I thank you for Christian and Camille. I pray, O God, your choices and richest blessing will be upon this family. And wherever they go, they will continue to be an asset to your memory, to your ministry. O God, we thank you, we praise you, we magnify you and glorify you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless. Thank you so much. God bless you. Come on. Bless you, son.
Appreciate you.
God bless you. Amen. Come on. You can remain on your feet. We're getting ready to say our dismissal. Amen. Amen. Some of these things are bittersweet. Amen. Amen. But we know when someone said they led to go somewhere, amen, you can't stop that. You can't mess with that. Amen. That's like a hammer thing. Can't touch this. Hallelujah. But we're so grateful again for the ministry and the service that they rendered while they're here. And I'm grateful for all of you. Amen. For your continued service. Is there anything else we forgot, ministers, officers? Amen. I did. I forgot something. No, let us bow our heads. Gracious God, our Father, we thank you for all you allowed us to experience from the words of exhortation and the prayer and the song and the ministry through the spoken word. I pray, O God, that your choices and richest blessing will continue to be upon this ministry, upon every family here, and just that we would continue to do everything you assigned our hand to do. O God, as we go leave this place, we pray that you would dismiss us from this place, but never dismiss us from thy divine presence. These things we ask in the awesome and matchless name of Jesus, and in Jesus' name we pray. And all who believe in the power of prayer say amen.
Amen.
Amen. You're not dismissed. Hallelujah. Enjoy the remainder of your day.